Hi everyone, I'm Dennis Foley from Acoustic Fields. We're the company that makes the activated carbon low frequency absorbers, and we also have our own proprietary foam. You can read all about us on our website at acousticfields.com. Today I'd like to talk about critical distance, and first I would like to start with the cover of our personal listening environment book to give you an idea of something we call free space. You can see from the drawing that this is free space listening. Basically, we don't have any boundaries. We don't have, the earth is a boundary because we're elevated with our speakers and listening position. We don't have any sidewalls because we're actually sitting in free space. And obviously, we don't have a ceiling. So the thing about free space listening is no boundaries. When we get boundaries inside of our room, then we have all these acoustical issues. To further our knowledge of room acoustics along, I would like to kind of divide the room, if you would, up into two general areas. Room sound and speaker sound, because they both produce sound, and I think if we separate the two and give some definitions of both, it'll help us along this acoustic journey of getting good sound in our rooms. Room sound is anything that's less than 300 cycles. Now, you'll see different numbers in the literature, but this is a good breakpoint for energy below 300 cycles. So anything below 300 cycles in most of our small room acoustic environments, we're going to get some room sound. We're going to get room sound in four areas, but we'll get to those areas in a few minutes. I want to go over here to the speaker side. The speaker side is anything over 300 cycles. And we won't talk too much about the speaker and its contribution to room sound today, because we're going to focus on acoustical distortions. But just let me give you an idea how important the speaker-room interaction paradigm is. We're all familiar with on and off axis response when it comes to speakers. Speaker manufacturers will always give you on and off axis responses for their speakers. The on and off axis response of most high-end good quality speakers, if you took the two graphs and superimposed them upon each other, they would not be the same, but the general movement of the energy across the spectrum on the graph would be the same. The shape would be the same of the graph, but maybe not the same numbers. That's critical. That's critical if we're going to have any kind of quality speaker sound. So just that little single one little variable can have a huge impact on the quality level of our music and our sound. Let's talk about room sound, less than 300 cycles. Well, of course, these are our longer wavelengths, so we're going to be putting all this energy into a room and it's not going to fit, especially below 80 cycles in most of our small rooms. So we're going to produce distortions. The first one, and the one we're all familiar with, is room modes, and that's the buildup of pressure, which smothers and blurs certain frequencies, can exaggerate other frequencies. Definitely not, these pressure areas are not wanted in critical listening environments. Sometimes in live rooms, there can be used for different sounds. But as a general rule in our listening and critical listening environments, they're not wanted at all. SBIE, speaker boundary interference effect. It's such a powerful phenomenon that it even has its own name. What is it? It's the impact the energy generating device the speaker has and is reacting with the closest room surface. Speaker boundary interference effect. There's an effect there, acoustical effect, and it can be all kinds of issues involved there. So you have to be very, very careful because it has a big impact on the frequency response, the overall frequency response of your room. Comb filtering, its name comes from the teeth of a comb. That's what it looks like on a graph. It's a series of reflections close together, blurring and smearing and exaggerating sound. Phantom images, if you will. Both SBIE and comb filtering produce phantom images, their own sound, if you will. So we don't want other artifacts in the room producing sounds. We just want our speaker and room to get along so we can hear all the music in the recording. Pore diffusion, that's a very, very common problem in small rooms. Small rooms need to acoustically sound like larger rooms. They need to sound like free space listening where there's no boundary surfaces at all. In order to do that, we have to use diffusion. and diffusion will spread the energy out more evenly in the room. So that's the goal of diffusion. If the energy is spread out more evenly in the room, it has a more natural, realistic sound. So two general areas I want you to think about: room sound, speaker sound. Less than 300 cycles is room sound. Speaker sound is greater than 300 cycles. Room sound has the four big acoustical distortions with the mold, the speaker boundary interference effect, comb filtering, and pore diffusion. Thank you.